Hello and welcome to the Budapest Grand Prix. It's finals time here in the Bock Arena in this fantastic city. Absolutely beautiful. So we have a presentation here of local heroes in Budapest. Fencing is a huge sport in Hungary. But I tell you what, we've got a huge guest here in the commentary box, Amber Siviero. Amber, you've been refereeing all day today, but they sacked you for the final.
No, it's okay. I'm happy to be here with you, Kerem, you know?
I'm very happy for you to be here as well. So today we've had some surprises through the day today. I think we've had in the men's competition some big names falling, and also in the women's competition. And so we're left with a lineup in the finals with Cimini and Cuomo, two Italians going up against each other in the men's competition, and Cohen from Israel.
True, but you know, Israel is a great fencer. I think Cohen is a European champion in title.
Yeah. And Cohen goes up against Pia, a French fencer who is bursting onto the scene here.
True, but he's not bursting in nationally. He really has high-level results in French competition. So he's a strong opponent, and in under 23 too.
So, and in the women's competition, which is coming out now, right now, in fact, Amber, we got the presentation of the women's semi-finalists. Should we throw to the stadium announcer? I think we should. So, Amber, presentation of all the athletes here for the women's semi-final. Napek Miaska from Poland against Nelly Differt from Estonia, and Mary Florence Kondasamy against Anna Kuhn from the host nation.
Yeah, it's really great that we have someone from Hungary. It's always, you know, with more emotion when we watch semi-final and final on the spot. And Kondasamy is also used to podium, to fence in finals.
So I know you're going to hate me for asking you this question, but do you think there's a favorite in the four?
Okay. Usually I have no favorite, you know, I care about fencing, and especially as a referee, I shouldn't have someone I prefer. But I'm. Kondasamy is a great fencer. As I said, she's used to fence in high level. And Kun is so nice as a fencer, and she's local, so I really hope that we will have the people behind us screaming a lot.
I think they will be screaming a very lot. And we have Kun and Kandasamy on piece right now. And as you can see, world number seven, Kandasamy.
I mean, she's got to be the favorite here, hasn't she?
Yeah, but fencing is full of surprise.
And pain is full of surprise.
True.
And your colleague, referee?
Yes, she is. Mirna is also having a lot of finals, a lot of experience. So let's see what happens in this match.
So here we go. They're going to test the guards. So you might think, oh, why are no lights coming up? Well, they test the guards to make sure there's no lights coming up on the guards because the whole body is target in Epe. And both fencers can hit at the same time.
And you can also see that they are on the piece, they are fencing with a 2 meter piece, but we only use 1.5 meters. Meaning that we won't use the blue side.
So here we go. Semi-final time, number one for the women's EPS. Anna Kun from the host nation on the left-hand side against Marie-France Kandasamy from France on the right-hand side. It's always a little bit cagey at the start of EPE matches.
Yeah, they have to look at each other. The start is very important. The first that you want to lead from the beginning. So you have to be patient and to know what you want to do.
And one hit in EPE is more important than the other ones.
I don't think it's more important, but when you have the advantage of leading, you can still score double hits, and you don't have that in saber and foil. Yeah. And see, the first hit came in the first minute. They were using the piece a lot.
Bit of second intention from Kandasamy?
We'll see for the next one, maybe.
Maybe.
The middle of the piece is always a tricky part that we want to be serious there, not to attack. More to try to take the error of the opponent.
So looking for a
distance, for example?
Exactly, yeah. So you're looking to... Oh, this is nice.
Yeah.
This is nice. Maybe we see a replay right now. Here we go. So if you look at this hit now, they passed each other and then around the world, as I like to call it, the flick around the back.
You see, again, we are staying in the middle of the piece, so they have to pay attention, maybe looking for the hand of the opponent. But it's really like provocation. What are you going to do?
So always creating, always trying to find an opportunity.
Yeah, it's important. Mm. Because if you are not active and it's the other one deciding, it's bad for you.
Busy footwork from Kandasamy.
Yeah, but she's also working a lot with the tip, as you can see. But maybe moving a bit too much. And that's an opportunity for Kun to hit.
So Kun with a silver medal here in 2022, her first Grand Prix medal. She's going to be on the podium for sure, but gold
which
perhaps?
Place?
Yeah, which place? Oh, this is a very nice touch.
See, that was in the middle and they are really looking for hands and closest part of the body and not the main body.
And just the tiniest of movements from Kandasamy opened up the bottom of the wrist and easy.
Kind of.
For them, it's easy.
True.
So Kandasamy pressing just a little bit more, trying to create something.
We are still very close to the middle of the piece, and we can see that they don't aim for the main part of the body. They are still keeping their distance.
Trying to pick off the, the easy target in front.
Well, the easy target, easy the target. Hard target, you mean.
Easy to the closest target, I should say. But Kandasamy does seem like she's trying to push the fight a little bit more.
True, but I'm not sure that the opponent really wants to go back.
No, no, she's definitely containing. Could today has been has pressed and pushed and been hard. Have you refereed her today?
Yeah, I refereed her with the Chinese lady, Lin. And she was actually fencing very well. It was a great match, very tense.
She won that quite convincingly as well, didn't she?
I think it was very tight at the beginning, but then the score is finally wide. But it was a very strong match. Both fencers were really good.
Do you think there's an advantage to fencing at home?
It's always an advantage because you have maybe the support of the public, maybe you have confidence because you speak the same language, you don't need to think if you need to buy some food or something, so maybe you're more relaxed and that's an advantage. But somehow can also be more pressure if your family's here. I think it really depends your personality.
And there's a big crowd here as well, isn't there?
Yeah,
there's a lot of home support. So, second period about to get underway, and Mirna Borshak is our referee for this fight. And so far, very tight indeed, but the host nation, Anna Kun, leading by 3 points to 2.
Do you think that they will still keep going in the middle of the piece, or that we will use more the end?
Hey, you're the expert.
I'm the expert of refereeing.
I think the way it looks to me is that Kandasamy is pushing just a little bit more than she was at the start. So I think that's a good carry on.
And she just catch up with the score.
So, I ask you the same question. Do you think they continue to push or stay in the middle?
I hope that they will also open the game with the distance. You know, not always a fence close to each other, but that we will see some more movement, like in the first hit, for example.
Yeah. Coming from a little bit far out, we've seen Kun do this today a lot, where she's attacking from just it seems a little bit far away.
Yeah, it's not too far. See, this one was also very nice because she changed the timing of attack. She was not waiting. She's, I think, trying to lead again. Like, as we say before, you need to be active when you want to score a hit.
Yes.
And I feel like the rhythm of the match has changed a bit, no?
For sure. At the beginning, it was this cagey, this not nervous, but looking at what each other are doing. And then Kandasamy is pushing, and now Kun looks like she's pushing, but...
Yeah, we can feel like Kun is willing to maybe attack more or be more... to put more pressure on his opponent, too, on her opponent.
Prêt? Allez.
That the movement is maybe going on the other side of the piece.
As a referee, does that put you under a bit of pressure when they go to one side?
No, because actually we can move. I can imagine for some competition we have to stand in the middle because of the camera and it's harder to referee. But when we can move, it's not a problem. That's another, a nice attack.
Another counter action. So Kun has come on, and we see on the replay here.
Yeah.
Fayed. Ali.
I think they are really looking to, you know, attack on preparation or yes. to spot the target at the right moment.
So very strategic, isn't it? They're looking at moments to find an opening, but at the same time creating. This is, I think, what some people miss with Saber, with Epe. They miss the creation.
Yeah, because Epe is very difficult sport because you can touch everywhere. So you also have to pay attention to what you do because double hit arrives very easily.
Yeah.
And if you look at their techniques, they are very precise from the beginning. Each time they get close to each other, there is a touch.
And they're hitting on very small parts of the target as well, on the wrist, on the hand, on the...
It's a very technique match.
Yeah. Nice. Very nice. A little bit of blade action there as well.
And we have 33 seconds before the break.
Another break?
Yeah, Kandasamy is leading with two hits.
And happy with the double. Sometimes people don't understand how important that double hit is.
True, and because with this double, she gets closer to 15 hits.
Exactly.
And that's an advantage for her and not for Kuhn. That she probably wants to catch up the score by one hit before the break, just because from tactically and mentally it would be better. So she's pressing on her opponent again.
Nice.
She tried.
Yeah. So trying to go underneath the wrist, underneath the hand, and Kandasamy
was
really sharp here. And in fact, the hit went underneath the wrist as well. Beauty of the replay here. And we go to a minute's break here. And Kandasamy leading by 10-7. Not over, for sure, but it's a great position to be in.
It's a great position, especially, you know, psychologically, when you reach the 10, you have two numbers. It's 10, it's not 9. So when you're the first one to reach that spot, you feel comfortable compared to your opponents.
Yeah. Double figures makes a big difference. So, Amber, we have 40 seconds to ask you, what's it like to be a referee?
Oh, it's a pleasure because the athletes are under the light, but we are the first row to see what is happening in sport, and that's a great position. Exactly, and actually we know before everyone which decision we're gonna make, and that's also great.
Is Epe easy to referee?
Oh, none of the weapon is easy to referee. They are all specific. Of course I do. No, but most of people think that Epe is just like, okay, there is no phrase d'armes, so you just have to raise the hand. But actually, the way you control the match is really important if you want your match to be smooth, if you want your match to be fair also for the fencers.
Third period, in fact, of this semi-final between Kuhn and Kandasamy. And I'm here with the amazing referee, Amber Seviero, and what a hit that was. Easy call for the referee. You don't have to worry about whether the piece has been hit or not, because it's earth, right?
Yes, that's right. Plus, you know, also to have this podium piece, and that's not too high for the referee, not too low neither. So you really have a good view about the hit on the floor or not. So it's a very good atmosphere here. It's a nice podium piece. And one hit more for Kandasamy. She's really getting close to 15.
Again, hitting on the inside of the wrist.
We didn't see that many touches on the main part of the body on that match, so that's really a good technique match. and the double, like we say.
Better for the leading athlete, and Kandasamy just one away from making the final here. I'm not sure Kun is going to match up to the silver medal she won last year.
It's going to be hard, true.
Doesn't seem to be creating so much, but as soon as I say that.
Well, once again, it's a very, very great touch.
Nice hit to the inside of the wrist. But Kandasamy in the box seat.
What is really hard in Epe is to avoid the double touch, because a double touch would put Kandasamy in final.
Looking likely right now, Kandasamy on the right-hand side. Just has to play the game. She's still working hard. She's still moving.
So Kun definitely need a single hit.
Just a little nervy, I think, from Anna Kun. Oh, lovely touch there. That's definite second intention. So she's thrown a fake attack, drawn Kandasamy out, and then hit with a counter. Beautiful hit.
She really needs to build a game like this, because, as we say, she has to avoid a double, meaning that she has to find all the means to have this single hit.
One light on the box.
And she still has time to catch up.
Yeah, plenty of time for sure, but no mistakes. No mistakes for Anna Kun.
She's getting closer.
And this is slightly different from the one before. She, we look now. She steps in and hits on the wrist. I mean, this is more direct than the one before.
It is. And Kandasamy is changing her weapon. Maybe she does not feel great with the one she got. Maybe she also needs time, you know, to think.
This is a moment for the athlete to say, okay, the weapon's fine, but actually I need a little bit of thinking time.
Yeah, exactly. And as a referee, she's not wasting time. She just has to change the rep to weapon, so we have to accept it.
So Kandasamy from France on the right-hand side, just one away from making the gold medal match, but Kun is fighting back very hard.
Atmosphere behind us. So one touch to equalize the score.
And it's shaping up to be a fantastic semi-final. Kun not out, coach, very happy with the situation. Kandasamy must be feeling the nerves now.
I think Kandasamy will try to go, you know, to be active, like we say at the beginning, because she still has chance with a double hit, with single hit. So she will probably need to protect an action.
She has a nice step lunge. I don't like, we haven't seen it so much in this fight.
Neither than the flash.
Or the flash, yes. The running attack. Flash is French for arrow.
And 20 seconds to go.
Amber, you're welcome back anytime. If you bring me a 14-14 in the semi-final of a Grand Prix, you can come back anytime.
That's the best situation. Like 14-14, that everybody wants that. That's a tense moment. What? And the referee will have to go to the video, of course, to decide.
Every time, of course, yeah. But what a matchup we have here. 14 apiece for a place in the gold medal match. Anna Kun. Yeah. and she's in to the gold medal match here today. Amber, what a...
Hölgyeim és uraim, egy egészen elképesztő feltámadás. Kunda Anna 2022 után ismét a döntőben. 9-14-ről fordítva, hihetetlen. Bravo Anna! Amazing comeback by the Hungarian Anna Kun.
Way behind her opponent, and we couldn't even feel like she was fighting for that, and suddenly one touch after the other, she just came back. That's great. And you know what I like? The last one. We have 13 seconds to the end, and she's not waiting for the priority minute. She's just going. She just decided that she wanted to win, and she goes immediately after the alley of the referee. She goes for the hit, and she scores. That's great.
Absolutely fantastic match. Kandasamy clearly the favorite going into the fight, but like you say, the desire, the urgency at the end from Kun was the one that won it. And here we have confirmation that Anna Kun has gone through in a 15-14 match, and Kun will be in the final. She's going for a second medal here in Budapest. Silver last time. I wonder if it'll be gold this time. Coming up very shortly, we will have the second women's semi-final here at the Budapest Grand Prix, the second Epe Grand Prix of the season, the second Grand Slam. And we'll find out who is going to face Anna Kun in the final. There is Nelly Difert from Estonia. She goes up against Poland's Renata Napek-Miaska.
And they are both experimented fencers. They are fencing in international competition for a long time. Once again, I expect this match to be also very technical. They know each other.
So semi-final number two, Dennis Nyong refereeing this match. And it's Difert from Estonia on the right-hand side up against Napek-Miaska from Poland on the left. Tough one to call, this one, Amber.
No, it's okay. It's not the worst. And they are also both really nice fencers, you know, with ethics and fair play behavior.
Yes.
So it's great to have them.
Estonia have had a pretty good time since winning their first medals in the Olympic Games. Lehis winning the first medal for Estonia in fencing in Tokyo.
And
then
the team
doing the big one.
Yeah, I think in Estonia they had a very good period with these different fencers, and the level could go higher and higher because they were really fighting among each other. And we can see the result. I mean, it's great fencing that they are producing.
And for a small country, quite a high level of high-level fencers.
It's
true. 5, 6, 7 fencers? Women especially.
But they also have now men fencing very well. And we can see that actually the junior men are coming stronger and stronger. And there is clearly a difference of size that Ms. Difert has to be aware and to be careful about.
So we talk about this in commentary a lot, the size of the fencers, and he's a big one, Burrell is huge, and does it actually make a big difference, or does it only make a difference to your style of fencing?
No, it makes a difference, but it's not... It's kind of an advantage to be taller because, you know, your distance is not the same and the size of your arm. So it's important. But it doesn't mean that because you're tall, you're going to win.
No.
And we know that because a lot of fencers are not the taller one in the world and they can still win bout, hopefully.
So it does make a difference in terms of, so Fiamingo tends to fence outside a distance and then jumps in. Whereas the taller fencers, Sun, for example, the Chinese fencer, she's quite happy to stand almost at any distance.
Yeah, that's true, because you still need space to be able to move your tips or your arm. But you also have shorter people that are happy to fence with a bigger distance than the opposite.
Yeah.
So that really depends also on your fencing style.
Yes. But as we like to say, anyone can fence. Doesn't matter what shape or size you are.
Exactly. That's why I think fencing is an amazing sport for that. You know, you don't need to be the tallest one. You can just be also smart or more physical, more tactical, more technical. I think fencing is really a complete sport.
Universal, yeah. Even I could fence, well, until I turned 50.
You did fence.
A long time ago. A long time ago. No one wants to see that.
Maybe we can find out some videos. And
okay.
The first passivity is coming, 1 minute without heat. And the new rules of passivity is it does not matter the score of the fencer. Both fencers will get P yellow card, P passivity card, and then it will be a P red card, and then we will go to black. So for the first yellow and red, does not matter the score, both fencer will get the card. And for the P black, only the fencer with the lowest score will receive it. And in case they are both equal, both fencer will receive the black card, but the highest seeding ranking will win the match.
Okay, so I spoke to your colleague, David Baker, yesterday. I said, what do you do at the end of the match when you have to give a P black? And he said, call DT.
Yeah, exactly. That's the correct answer, because if the score is not equal, it's easy. The one we will win is the leader of the score.
Of course.
But if the score is tight, we don't know the ranking by heart. Personally, there is way too many fencers for me to remember that. So the decision belongs to the technical directory. We will ask him, and
the
they
DT
will say
the organizing committee there. Yeah. And so you would go to the DT to call this?
Probably the DT for the final and will be close to the piece.
Yeah. So here we go. It's the second period of the women's semi-final here. Number two, Renata Napek-Miazga against Nelly Differ. Poland versus Estonia. 3-3, and we've had a passivity card. Amber, you very eloquently told us the rules of passivity, but it's changed from last year.
It did. And actually, I think it's more simple now to understand it. And we go directly from yellow, red, black, and not the yellow, red, black that we used to have.
So just one red card and then straight to black.
The difference is also does not matter the score, both fencer will receive the first yellow and red.
So tell me, from my ill-educated position, doesn't make such a difference.
Another one. So that's the P red card we were talking about. And because it's a red card, both fencer will also have a hit against them. And they will start again from the en garde line. So if there is again 1 minute without heat, both fencer will receive a P black card. But normally we won't get through that because they know it's not a good deal for the weakest ranked one.
Yeah, well, Napek-Miazga is the highest ranked fencer. So Differ has no choice here. She has to push.
Yeah, especially now that the score is different.
En garde.
So we've finally got an intriguing situation with this penalty situation. We haven't seen it so much through the season.
No, that's true. I think maybe the fencers are less willing to play with the passivity because it's now shorter than before. And also
and the
because
whole
it
idea
goes
was to make them fence.
Yeah, exactly. Is that the point of it's a combat sport, so they have to fight.
But Now we have a tight situation. Napik Miazga seems to be the one that's pushing, but actually Differt has taken the lead here. Nice locked half.
Yeah, that's why it's a nice parry post to touch.
On guard. Prep. Ali.
But yeah, I was going to say, doesn't it make more difference in the team competition, this new rule?
I think they are less looking for the passivity, actually. But often still, at the beginning of the match, we still have this period, this 1 minute period where they are looking at each other, and often we do have passivity.
Yeah. The day I think we've seen at the beginning of fights, you get that 1 minute, they get the passivity card, and then someone tries to do something. The more experienced fencers seem to, in the last, when it gets to 51, 52 seconds, they tend to go for a hit.
Yeah, true. That's really the only, the beginning of the match, this observation phase. And then I think now we do have a lot of fencing, more actions.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the idea, the concept of this stopping them from bouncing around for 3 minutes doing nothing, the idea of the rule is a good rule. And I'm not.
It's effective. Exactly. It is.
I'm not entirely sure how the adaptation of taking the one red card out is making a big difference, but you've told me, the other referees have told me, it's making a big difference.
Yeah, and also, you know, by team, now we don't have these P black cards that allow you to make the substitution entering the match. It's more fair. Because when you had, for example, a team with three person and the other one with four, you start with an advantage, and that's not normal.
So here we are, second semi-final, all square here between Differt and Napik Miazga. Napik Miazga here taking on a little bit of fluid, but seven apiece. And to be honest with you, you talked about in the first semi-final, it stayed quite central, quite in the middle. This one also.
That one also. I think we had one action on the right, completely on the right of the piece, one on the left. And as we say, also very technical ladies trying to hit the closest part of the body, like hand.
Yeah, trying to hit on the inside. Here we see Differt perhaps been a little bit in the shadow of Believa, Kerpu, Lehis, of course. And now on the main piece, in the podium here in Budapest.
And we start again for the third period. So both fencer have this P red card, meaning that we will see more action now in the last period.
Oh, I think so. And it's got to be Differt that's the one that pushes a little bit more because she's the lower ranked fencer. If we have a minute without any fencing, she's out.
And, so she has this pressure. But also, we can see that Knapik is not willing to give her the piece. She's pushing, but it's also tactical for her to push. And we have a double hit now.
Estonian coach looking a little nervy here. So Napik Miazga still pressing.
It's also tactical for her because if she wants 1 minute to pass, she also has to lead with the field, even if it's really unlucky that we have 1 minute without hit. And distance is really, really close.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that Napik is using her her size yet, because she's pressing and pressing her opponent.
And not using that long distance because
exactly.
She's taller. Yeah.
And the score is still tight.
But the advantage is with the pole. It's interesting because last season we saw the Polish team, the women's team, doing so well. Now
that's a nice action. And Diefert is asking for video.
For what?
I think the referee will have to focus on the halt timing, and also is she turning back or not.
Yeah.
That's often a problem, you know, with left-handed and right-handed fencers.
Looked
because
okay to me.
If, for example, the right fencers goes on the back of the left fencer, it's not the fencer turning back, it's just like the opponent going on her back. And in this case, it's not a mistake, because the mistake is really turning the back to the opponent.
Yes, yeah.
And sometimes can happen that your opponent is going on your back and it's not your fault.
I think the easiest.
So that's a halt. That's probably for the Korakor, but let's see what's going to happen next.
Korakor is what?
Korakor is the main part of the body touching the other main part of the body. Sometimes for, you know, very tiny contact, like knees to knees, we don't say halt.
But if your chest goes to chest, you stop the fight.
Yeah, we must say halt, but it's literally the halt of the referee that stops the bout and not the contact. So on this action, referees, Leon say it's just halt on a good timing, you know, with the contact. That's why the hit was not given. And Miss Knapik is leading by two right now.
Nice little hit as well. Nice little surplus flick to the wrist. For those in the know, for those in the vernacular, little circular movement of the blade and a flick over the top. Too far?
It's never too far, you know.
It looks too far from me.
Oh,
she's attacked.
I saw the score.
She's attacked with Octave, a big blade movement.
That's right. I thought you meant the score, because we could see in the last match that the score is never, the match is never over until the end.
No, but in the final minute, three hits in Epe is huge.
It's huge, but we know it's possible.
Four is even worse.
That's true, but 48 seconds is still very long. But once again, she has to avoid the double, so
yeah,
it's really
hard. Yeah. But we saw her come back from 14-11 in the last semi-final, and now 13-10.
You would be happy with a comeback again, huh?
I think I might be. Yeah. Impartially. I'm not supporting
one or the
other. Of
course, that's just for the tension.
Yeah.
Just like, I think in fencing, we have this moment like with more subit, sudden death, and with equal score at 14-14. That's so emotional that everybody likes this moment. Yeah. Maybe not the fencer.
Maybe
lose,
not the referee.
No, the referee also. It's, you know, the fencers, they like to fence for the tension, for the emotion, but the referee is the same. We are also looking for this kind of adrenaline. And once
again. Wow, look at this. Amber Siviero, you must come back to the commentary box every time you're at a competition.
It's the fencers on the pist.
Yeah.
Did the actions. Not me, I'm just happy to see that.
You're making 14-14 happen twice already.
Let's see.
I think it's going to happen.
That's really nice catch up. That was a very great parry riposte.
Nice little octave riposte there, yeah. Really nice.
And now the score is tight again. 20 seconds to go.
Differt. Wow, I was just about to say, Differt seems to be pressing, but she's just decided to back off.
That's often the problem. You know, when you catch up the score, most of people think, oh, yeah, I've done it. But it's not enough. You need to score one more hit. That's why I really appreciate the end of the match of Kuhn, because she equalized, but she went for it.
She pushed, yeah.
It's interesting, isn't it, that you, if you're four or five hits behind and you get level and then you just decide, oh, okay, that's fine, I'm finished now.
And that's a common mistake. So the priority is on the left side. They do have 1 minute to score. The first one scoring is going to win.
And no score?
And no score means that Knapik is going to win. Okay. But right now it's a double hit. It does not count, of course, because it is a priority minute. Once again, a double hit.
It's close though, wasn't it?
True. What the referee should pay attention at this moment is the distance. And that's exactly what he asked the fencer for, because it's a tricky moment. So you really, they are not starting at 4 meters away, because that's only at the beginning of the match. But you really want them to not be able to touch the point at the beginning of the match.
Four, four, four. They're both going for it, aren't they? Do you feel the pole is just containing?
No. Once again, that's impressive. So Difert is really going for the hit. And we talked about that later. The fencer need to be active. And right now we can see that Difert is really, really active for the hit. That's a very tense hand of match.
She keeps going octave, though. She keeps going, taking the blade and going into the low line, doesn't she?
Yeah, but probably Knapik will go for the hit soon, because Difert is leading a lot.
And there she's going. She saw, she predicted this octave and she went round it.
Yeah, that's a great movement. She was right to do that, because Difert was, you know, making pressure, and the distance was very close. So she did well to start. We can see that.
Brilliant stuff there from Renata Knapik-Miazga. She goes through to the final of the Women's Epee Grand Prix here in Budapest. So Knapik-Miazga will face Anna Kun in the women's final. Brilliant stuff here. Coming up very shortly, we'll have the two men's semi-finals. Don't go too far, we'll be back very soon.
Ismételten a fináléba, és ellenfele a lengyelek napig Miazga lesz. És akkor nincs megállás, hamarosan néhány percen belül folytatjuk is, mégpedig a férfiak elődöntőivel. So up next, the semi-finals of the men's competition in a few minutes. Két finálé, a női és a férfi döntő, és utána természetesen díjátadó ceremónia, úgyhogy nagyjából a fél 9-9 magasságáig számítunk az önök figyelmére itt a bokcsarnokban. So four rounds left, the two semi-finals in the men's competition, and those will be followed by the women's final, and then of course the men's final. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the participants of the semi-finals in the Men's Epic Grand Prix in Memoriam győző kulcsát. Hölgyeim és uraim, kérem fogadják szeretettel a kulcsát győző emlékére rendezett West End Grand Prix férfi párbajtörviadal elődöntőinek résztvevőit.
Time now for the men's semi-final here at the Budapest Grand Prix, the second Epe Grand Slam of the season.
Representing Italy, Olaszország képviseletében Gabriele Civini. Also representing Italy, szintén Olaszországból Valerio Cuomo. Representing Israel, Israel képviseletében Jonathan Cohen. Representing France, Franciaországból Gaetan Villa. And please welcome the referees of the semifinals. Kérem, hogy üdvözöljék a zsűri tagjait is. David Baker, Eyad Magaire, Montikis Dominika, and Denis Ostrowski. So let's start with the first semi-final, the next competition. Jöjjön tehát a férfi verseny első elődöntője.
So introductions done here in the Bock Arena. We start with an all-Italian lineup for the first semi-final. Gabriele Cimini against Valerio Cuomo. Italy versus Italy, and I'm delighted to say I have a Swiss friend in the commentary box. Amber Saviero. Amber, Italy are one of the most successful nations in fencing. It's no big surprise to see two Italians in the semi-final.
Not for two Italians, but Cuomo is a very young fencer. We know he's very talented, but it's not the lineup we would have expected. So that's great to have always new fencers coming up. And for sure, Italy is definitely a strong nation. This match will be without coach because it's the same nation, but we can still expect a very tense match.
We talked about passivity in the women's competition. Do we expect passivity here?
I don't think so. Even if they really know each other because they are used to fence together a lot, normally they are more the type of game they are producing game. So we should not have that. And we can see that the movement from the beginning
straight
of the match, away they are going, they are moving faster, and they are using the strip.
Cimini, with the experience, you think is the favorite?
It's maybe when you have more experience, you're the favorite, but you also have this pressure on you.
Yeah.
And Cuomo has nothing to lose. It's his, I think, first podium in a senior competition.
Two-time world champion as a junior, I believe, or cadet world champion and junior world champion.
So for sure, he's not unknown. We know him.
We know he's a great fencer. And dad is also quite good.
Yes, true. He was also national coach for Italy. So let's see, because Cimini is a more defensive type game, but Cuomo wants to lead, and I think he's not here for like passivity, or he wants to be active, he wants to fight, to lead.
So, hey, maybe I can tell you something you don't know.
Tell me, please.
So, Cuomo,
son of father.
The Cuomo we're watching.
Yes.
He can switch between French grip and pommel.
Okay, so
you
think he's
that,
using. No, because you know when I don't think I referee him and that he changed the weapon in the middle of the match, so it's not something I know. I think he's using the pistol grip on this belt. Do you see from here? And the referee is giving the passivity yellow card for both fencers, and the score is not equal, as you can see.
This
but
is
still,
the first time I've seen this.
Yeah, really?
First
it
time
happened.
I've seen when the score's not been the same.
Okay, it happened a lot today. We had that, but true. The score is not equal, and both fencers receive the P yellow card.
But go back to this pistol grip and pommel grip.
So it's not mainly the fencers, they keep the same grip because they are used to. But why not changing the grip if you want to adapt your game?
And for people that may be watching and haven't seen fencing before, what's the difference between pistol and...
So the French grip is mainly straight, and you can hold it with all your finger close to each other.
And it gives you a little bit of extra reach?
Yeah, exactly. You can hold it, for example, close to the guard, and maybe that allow you to make stronger parry riposte.
Yeah.
And you can hold it further from the guard in order to have a bigger, larger distance.
A bit of reach, yeah.
And the pistol grip is orthopedical grip, so you hold it mainly close to the guard, but
tight,
you have more
tight
strength.
Tight to the guard, yeah.
And almost tight, because you can have this part of the grip longer also.
But it's not just strength, it's also the accuracy of the movement, right?
I think in with boss grip you can be very accurate. We can see that, for example, in Epe when
we're
they manage
have an
to...
argument here, because I think pistol grip gives you more precise...
You think so?
Yeah.
Let's make a sondage and ask the fencers.
Okay, no problem. We'll do that after the competition. Here, though, we see Cimini leading by 3 points to 1 passivity card called when the score wasn't equal. I haven't seen that today, but you clearly have.
I did. And once again, in this semi-final, we can see that in the first 3 minutes, it's really the part where the fencers are looking to each other, because it doesn't matter if it was woman or man match. The score is really low and tight during the first period.
Not so unusual in Epe?
No, it's not. That's why they really need this time to build their game and to know what kind of tricks they can manage and they can do with the fencer.
And is it all about exploration? Is it all about looking and seeing? Or is it just a bit of a gamble, you know, I don't want to lose too much?
I don't think it's a gamble. That's definitely a part of observation. But you can also not have observation. There are some fencers, they know their game. They don't mind about the timing. They just go for the hit. But basically, especially when you know each other, you need to see, like, okay, are you going to weak this way, or are you going to be the first one to fail, and I can reach you that way.
So, Abba, you coach, right? You coach.
Yeah, I do coach also.
And which weapons?
Right now in Epe and Sabre, but I'm a former coach of foil.
The best weapon, obviously. No.
The weapon, you mean?
Oh,
no, we are watching Epe. Epe is the best today.
Of
today.
Course. Of today, it's the best weapon. And we're about to start the next period of this semi-final. Chromo versus Cimini. Cimini leading by one, but passivity cards given. And they're both moving hugely. But let's go back to you coaching. You coach young people, old people, everyone?
So in my club right now, I mostly have young people under 17 and under 20, because it's the club is not old. It has only 25 years old, but we are rebuilding it. So I do have young kids. But fencing is a sport that you can do from 4 or 5, depends the country where you are, until your death, actually.
Until you're my age.
No, even more. So +2 for Cimini. And they are still moving a lot. But like we say, Cimini likes to defend. He feels great in his part of the field, meaning that Cuomo, especially because the score is under Cimini, he has to go.
Well, the way Cimini's moving as well, he's stepping in and drawing out Valerio Cuomo to attack him, stepping away and just hitting him with the counter.
Yeah, or also to change the distance, sometimes to make parry, sometimes to go on the action like we just see. But for sure, I think Cimini is really feeling comfortable on his side of the piece.
Yeah.
We can see that actually he does not even want to go.
No, he's not pressing at all.
Forward the on-guard line. Mm. So Cimini is, for example, not really defending, but is fencing on his side of the field. Does not mean that he is not active.
Yes. So that's
That's a really nice
touch. I wonder so
there was
that.
There was a crossing, and Cimini failed to hit when his opponent was in front of him, and he touched during the crossing. So the hit is definitely good.
So we talked about crossing a little bit over the last couple of weeks. Amber and I have been doing some studying of fencing, and crossing is a really critical part of fencing.
It is. We have to consider several things. Like we say, the piece is 1.5 meters, and we can see that Cuomo is very much fencing at the edge of the piece.
It's clutched right to the left-hand side, yeah.
Exactly. And if Cuomo is going forward and passing his opponent, we have to consider if he's staying on the piece, maybe going outside on the lateral boundary. And for crossing is something very important, because it's not the same as if you stay on the piece, if you go outside. For the referee, it makes huge difference.
And to be clear about crossing the piece, for the audience that may not know about fencing, we see these two blue lines down the side of the piece. 1 foot, 2 foot, both feet? What's the rule?
Okay, so as soon as you go out of the piece on the lateral boundary with 1 foot, the referee must say halt. And then to decide if the action is whether good or not, it depends on the timing of the action and the halt of the referee. We had no example here, but it's basically the timing of the halt and the timing of the hit. But if you go outside with 2 feet on a lateral boundary, you cannot have the hit. It's not possible. It's forbidden by the rules. But your opponent
can hit you.
Yeah, he can hit you if he is still on the piece and you are outside. But he also has reasonable timing to do that. He can't waste 2 times of fencing. He has to hit right away.
Yeah, there's this notional value of fencing time.
So basically the fencing time is a time for you to make a simple action.
So to lunge or to...
To lunge, to straighten your arm, to, for example, make straight or disengage. This is one simple time. You cannot have attack composé, for example, because it is too fencing time.
So you can't do parry cart 1-2. This is too much.
Exactly. But... doesn't matter if it's your riposte, your attack or counterattack, you have 1 fencing time to touch your opponent once he's outside of the piece or when he goes behind you.
And this is a fascinating thing about fencing, because you have two experts standing on the piece, fighting each other, a referee who's an expert as well.
And the assistant also, because we have 2 sides referees.
And 2 extra referees. And all 5 people can have a different opinion about the same hit.
And if you add the coach can also have a different opinion.
The 2 coaches, yeah. But they always have the opinion that their fencer has scored.
Not always. But, you know, it's also the referee stays straight at the piece, and the coaches, they are at the angle. So sometimes we don't see the same thing.
Yes,
and sometimes, actually, the position can be better at the end of the piece.
Of course. But it's always hard. As you know, as a coach, I have coached as well. You always think your fence has scored. But here we are going into the second break. 8-3 for Gabriella Cimini. He's bossing this one, right?
True. But who knows? We had to come back for the ladies, why not for the men?
But if it's not 14-14, you're fired.
I will probably be fired. I doubt they will go to 14-14 again, but it would be excited if they do.
Yeah. But you talked right at the beginning about the movement of Gabriele Cimini, and he has bossed this fight. He's been in control.
Yeah, that's right. And let's see if he will keep the strategy, keeping his beast, the side of the beast, and we can see that it's starting the same way. So Cuomo is asking the referee to test his weapon. In case the weapon does not work, the referee can cancel the hit of Cimini, but in this case, the weapon of Cuomo was working, so the referee gives a hit to Cimini.
David Baker from Australia, the referee for this fight. Is your boyfriend?
No, he's not. My boyfriend is also international referee, but he's not here today.
Epe referee?
Yes, he is a pair referee. You know also one interesting thing that we can see on this fight, they are fencing completely at the end of the piste, and often we think that the piste is 14 meters. That is right for the last boundary for the edge. But the lateral side still counts after the rear limit of the piste.
Yes.
So, for example, if Cimini is fencing there and his back foot is going outside of the piste, but
the
behind
side.
The rear limit on the side, it is still outside of the piste.
This is quite an interesting point in terms of when someone is pushed off the boundary, isn't it? So that's why it's so important the side of the piste is... the referee has to understand what the side of the piste is.
Yeah, so the piste is really... Imagine that it is infinite for the back foot when you are stepping back.
Yes.
And it's also difficult for the fencers with this kind of piste because they are 2 meters wide and they don't feel the difference between the 1.5 meters and the sides. They can't feel it under their feet, so it's difficult for them to know where they are on the piece compared to others that are shorter.
And it's also difficult for some referees when you start these competitions.
Yes, it
is. You have referees from the local nation who may be doing their first international, and they don't...
It's difficult for all of us because we need to adapt. We need also to inform the fencers because maybe they've been fighting on a different piece today and they did not realize that on this one we are going to only use the middle of the piece. And it's very hard for the referee to watch this action because the back foot of Cimini is on the side, the back foot of Cuomo on the other side. And
and when you're below as well with a raised piece, is that harder?
Yeah, not harder, but still hard because we can't look at everything at the same time. So the position of the referee is really important to catch the boss feet, the machine also to see the light in the good timing.
But Cimini here is doing a stunning job against his opponent. I think Cuomo, he's still working hard, but very difficult now.
Yeah, especially when, like we say, Cimini is really strong when he's fighting on his side of the piste. So it's harder for Cuomo, but why not having a comeback again?
Why not? That's what we all want, of course.
Of course, because it's more tension.
But Cimini in control of this match with just over a minute left to go. This for a place in the gold medal match of the men's Epee Grand Prix. Coming up after this match will be
the second semi-final with the French Pila.
Yeah, Gaetan Pila and Jonathan Cohen. The young Israeli against the young Frenchman.
So actually, we do have a lot of young men fencers in these semifinals. So I do think we lost maybe Romain Canon with
he lost Pilar a galley. He lost a galley. No, he lost a galley, I think, earlier on.
Yes, you're right. So he lost to a French.
I'm like a clock. I'm right twice a day.
And we are also missing Borel in this competition. That's why
injured.
Yeah.
But we lost to Closy. We lost. We've lost a lot of top seeds. I mean,
that's Menepe.
And Epe, especially.
And the level is very high. And
the depth of quality in men's Epe is particularly high, isn't it?
It is. It's not rare to see some very good fencer not qualify for the last 64, for example.
Yeah.
So we have -2 for Cuomo.
Closer than it was before, though.
Yeah, but still, this famous double hit that helped Cimini and not Cuomo.
Exactly. So we're coming into the closing stages of this semi-final.
So we are -1 to equalization. And so should we bet on a 14-14?
I don't want to bet you, Anna, because, you know, we're friends. But
14-13. Yeah, so now
this
Cuomo
is dangerous.
He has to prepare his next touch.
Looks like he's doing that. Trying to set this one up. I wonder if he's going to take the blade here as well.
I don't know. We feel like Cimini is more active than before.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a double hit.
Oh, yes. That's close, though, isn't it? It was close. But Gabriele Cimini did it in the early stages, took the lead, and high five between the two Italians. But it is Gabriele Cimini of Italy through to the gold medal match here in Budapest.
15-14 against competitor Valerio Cuomo.
So confirmation that Gabriele Cimini from Italy is through to the men's Epe gold medal match at the Budapest Grand Prix. He did it in the early stages, right? He did it early on.
He was leading a while. So actually the score is really tight at the end because we could feel that Cimini was going away with the score. And finally we get the 15-14, but without the 14-14 expected.
And but that movement you talked about earlier on, he was quite happy to be in his own half, but he was moving all the time right from the start.
True. And that's because he was leading that he could also fence in his part of the piece. That's why the beginning of the match, like we said, is really important, because if you are leading, you can choose your favorite maybe spot on the piece.
So you get to choose your own tactic if you get that. And in Epe, it really is just one point, right? One point lead is enough.
It's never enough. But you have this double hit that can help you.
Yeah. Well, coming up very shortly, we'll have the second men's semi-final. And I'm delighted to say, Amber Siviero from Switzerland, one of the master list referees from the FIE, will be back to bring you her expert analysis.
So the two participants of the second semi-final events competition, please welcome on the pist from Israel, Yonatan Cohen. And his opponent from France, Gaëtan Bilia.
So time now for the second semi-final of the men's Épée Grand Prix here in Budapest. What a lineup we have for this one. Gaëtan Bilia, the world number 97, up against Yonatan Cohen, the world number 62. It can only happen in Épée. It can only happen in Épée. Men's Épée, semi-final number two. The winner of this fight will go up against Gabriella Cimini in the gold medal match. I'm Karen Bashir, and I'm here with Amber Siviero. Amber, it can only happen in Épée.
Yes, that's true. As we say, the level of men Épée is impressive. We can have these two guys, and they are not beginners. I mean, they are strong, but that's the first time they reach that level.
First podium match for these two here, and we are underway. But you talked about the level. I mean, the depth of men's Épée is huge.
Yes, it is. And we see more and more country involved in men's Épée with a very high level. So it's going to be difficult, and soon we will have the Olympic qualification starting, and I can't wait to see the first World Cup.
Yeah. April the 3rd, nice tack from the right from Cohen.
And Cohen is known for having a very fast game. He is maybe a bit less observative than his opponent, so probably we will have more touch in the first period.
It's worked for him all day today, though, the way that he's approached the matches with this aggressive.
That's true. He moves a lot. And he beat earlier in the day some very tough fencers. So in tableau 16, he had to fight with Limardo Gascon, and we know that Limardo is a client, you know.
Yeah, London 2012 Olympic champion. But can aggressive Épée fencing work all the time?
Not all the time, because I think one of the main difficulty in Épée is that when you attack or when you are aggressive, you also can be hit by your opponent. So you want to take risks, but not too much.
Yeah.
And as we say, the score is already 3-2, and we still have 1:30 to go, and once again they are scoring a double hit. So definitely we're going to have a fastest match. Faster match than the other.
Have you seen Bilia much today?
I haven't refereed him. I know him from some national competition when I used to referee in France. So he's fencing very well. His level improved a lot. I think this season he has also reached top 64 in Senior World Cup.
This is, for the pair of them, it's a debut podium. But I was talking to Gauthier Grumier, the number two of French Épée coaching. He said,
He's doing okay.
For sure he is. I mean, he's fencing in semi-final. But Cohen is definitely a strong opponent. And he dare to do action, you know, even in the middle of the piste. He's going for main part of the body, and it does not wait for his opponent to make mistake. He is also creating an active fencer.
Often the way with countries that are perhaps new or not so successful in fencing, it requires one person to do something. And Freilich from Israel winning the European Championships, what, 4 or 5 years ago?
True. And you know, they also have a very good woman team in Israel.
Yes, yes, very good.
So it's not maybe not the main country in fencing, but they are always there. They are really opponents that we should be aware. They are good fencer.
Yeah. Nice, very nice hit from Biar there.
What?
Maybe not second intention. Maybe the first attack failed and then pushed.
Yeah, but he was still here. He was paying attention and he was ready to put the point again. And once again, he's going, he's leading, but he's still going for the hit.
It's straight in, very direct. But there's a little bit of beer that reminds me of the Olympic champion. The way he moves, the way he's very straight, he's very upright. Very classic.
True. And they are both using French grip.
So that's been a really
first
entertaining
period,
first
done
bout.
And dusted. But it is Cohen from Israel leading by 8 points to 6. And Gauthier Grumier here talking to BA. He's been coaching him all day today. He said he's in good form, he's looking good, he's looking strong, but he's very happy with the result so far. But Cohen, as you said right at the beginning, very direct, in the middle, going for it. He looks in control.
He looks in control, but both fencers, they can win this bout. We can't know who's going to win yet. So Bila can definitely overpass the score of Cohen, especially after the break, because this time where the coach gives some advice is really important for fencers who don't really know each other, because they don't really know each other. They've been, of course, fencing together in junior, but this moment with the break can be decisive.
Second period here of the second men's semi-final. And again, Cohen out of the block straight away on the attack, gets a double.
2 seconds, double, but the double is still good for him. And he gives no time to his opponent to build his game, you know, because Bila wants a single hit. But he needs time to prepare, and Cohen is not giving him this time.
So no thinking time.
And once again, he's going, and double hit is definitely good for Cohen.
Fast. It's fast for Epe. I mean, like you say, there's no thinking time for the trailing fencer. But the fact that they are both. Oh, that's a nice hook, though. That is a nice hook.
That's interesting to see how Cohen will react. Will he still be pushing Bila and not letting him time to think, or will he start to create a different game? But he's going straight away, and Bila was ready for this one. And now we do have a tight score again. It's 11-11.
Nice old block as well from the Frenchman. Leveling things up, so now what happens? predictions?
No prediction. I don't want to guess this time.
14-14?
Even 11-11, but we still have two periods, so for sure they will score some hits and we will go to the end of the score.
So on the second time of asking from Cohen, he launched the flash attack direct to the body and then picked up the blade and picked up the lead again.
So plus two, it's going to be tough for Bilal to come back. Do you think that Cohen is going to give him the time to think, or will he go straight away again?
I think you've predicted it already. Cohen is... he's in your face the whole time. He's right in there. So even going backwards, he's keeping the distance quite close.
Yeah, and it does not really give the blade to his opponent, so it's hard for Bilal to build a single hit. He is looking for the distance.
Killing time?
Not killing time, like taking the time for this very important hit. And now 14-12, we know that it's going to be tough to go this to this 14-14. But there is still time.
There's still time, but you've got to look at Bia and think he's got to either take the blade, he's got to... But you were saying that Cohen's keeping the blade out of the way.
He has to play either with the distance or with the blade. And Cohen once again is going, so we do have Cohen now in final.
Thanks from him. Today, he has fenced so well and pushed right the way through from the start of the match. And he's through to the men's Épée Grand Prix final, where he'll face Gabriella Cimini. Well, it's a stunning performance for him right from the start. And you said right away he's going at it from the beginning.
It was this kind of game from the beginning. He was very generous and also very, very active. And it works. I mean, he is final now.
So confirmation that Yonatan Cohen from Israel is through to the Budapest Épée Grand Prix men's Épée gold medal match. He's beaten his opponent 15-12, and we'll see him very shortly. Coming up next, it's the women's final here in Budapest.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the participants of the final at the Women's Épée Grand Prix in memoriam József Sákovics. Hölgyeim és uraim, kérem fogadják szeretettel a Sákovics József emlékére rendezett West End Grand Prix női párbajtörviadal döntőjének résztvevőjét.
Thank you.
time now for the West End Grand Prix from Budapest, women's epee gold medal match. Presentation of the athletes and the officials for this gold medal match here at the Budapest Grand Prix. I'm Karen Bashir and I'm here with Amber Siviero. Amber, I've got to ask you, who is going to win this match?
Oh, I give no pronostic for that. That's the beauty of the sport, you know, to watch it until the end, to know. And now that we do have Kuhn, a Hungarian girl, in the final, it does not matter who is going to win, because we will have this atmosphere.
Yes, for sure. Anna Kuhn on the right-hand side, going up against Renata Lepek-Miaska. And we're underway. Kuhn got the silver medal last year. So she's here in the final to try and get herself one place higher. Silver medal, her first Grand Prix medal on home soil. Can she go better?
Better than the gold, no, but better than the silver, yes, she can. And if she's here, it means that she has been fencing well all day.
Yeah,
and it's
good.
Not, I mean, she was there last year. She's still here. It means that she's a very, very strong fencer. And still this minute of observation, the referee will have soon to say halt for the passivity. So now we do have P yellow card on the left and on the right side.
So what's P yellow? What does that mean?
That's passivity. It means that it has been 1 minute without score or without hit that the referee gave or not to the fencer. And we are still fencing in the middle of the piste. If in the next 42 seconds there is still no hit, the referee will have to go through another passivity with a red P card. Like we say before, the first hit of a match can be very important for the rest of your strategy. That's why they are really looking at each other, trying, testing your opponent's reaction before being able to launch the real touch that she wants to give to the opponent. We are 5 seconds to the next passivity.
Close, isn't it? It's close.
And we are going to have it. That's
wow.
Another P red card. And the score is going to be 1-1 because the referee has to give the hit because it's a P red card. They start again from the en garde line. And if they are not fencing again and the time goes to zero, that's also a possibility for a passivity, even if the time is 0 seconds.
And black card? Right?
It would be a black card.
A black card means disqualification?
It will be a P black card. So P black card is completely different from the normal card that we have. A passivity black card would mean like you lose a match, but you don't lose your ranking of the competition.
Right.
But we had a double hit right now.
We have a
36 seconds.
But it can still happen again.
Yeah, but not in this period.
And if we get this extra passivity, not now, obviously, in the second period, if we were going to get it, what happens?
So the highest ranking, because the score is equal, the highest ranking fencer we will it means that it should be Kuhn. And if the score is not equal and we do have the P black card, it will be the fencer with the highest score that wins the match. And so we know now it goes to the break.
So this is the first time today I've seen, you've been refereeing all day, so I'm sure you've seen more. This is the first time today that I've seen two passivity cards in the first 3 minutes.
Yeah, that's true. It's not very common. It's because this match is very decisive, important, and no one wants to take the risk to try an action. They really want to lead first. That's why we have this situation.
So it's like a gamble, right?
It's not a gamble. It's more tactical. And Kuhn knows that she had this advantage. Yeah. If her opponent is not going, she will win. So actually, the pressure is on Kuhn-Napik right now.
But incredibly, we talk about Epe fencing being cagey and tight at the beginning. This is incredibly tight.
It is, but the fencers, they know the rules, so Kuhn-Napik will have to go. Or maybe Kuhn can also use that advantage and make...
To decide to attack.
Yeah, to attack, like she can pretend like she's defending and suddenly she might go.
So start of the second period of this women's gold medal match. Renata Nepik-Miazga on the left-hand side up against Anna Kuhn from Hungary, the host nation. All tied up at two apiece, but we've had two passivity calls already.
And we will have soon a hit, and it will be decisive for the tactic of the match. Knapping is pushing Kuhn.
She has to.
She has to. And Kuhn knows that Kuhn-Napik will have to go, and she's going right now. That's a double hit.
So how much do they learn from that double?
For now, I think not that much. But it's also a way, if Kuhn does not want to attack because she thinks that her best tactic will be to defend, she still has this advantage with the passivity. So double hit is a way to save it also. We can see that they are very active with the legs to find the distance, but both of them have the point, the tips that still threaten the opponent.
They're in distance, aren't they?
Yeah, they are really, really close.
Ooh,
she tries. See, the distance was close. Actually, Kuhn-Napik was going forward and forward, and Kuhn starting her action, but finally, that's a double hit. She is not giving her field too much, like Kuhn is. She's going a bit backward, but she does not want to give the field to Kuhn-Napik too early.
So a light coming up spuriously there, and no hit will be given for that one. This happens every now and again.
Could happen. It's just like she probably hits the tip of her opponent. And when such a hit occurs, the passivity minute restart, because that's a hit that is not valid for the referees. And she's all once again going. Kuhn is going, but that's a double hit.
She's trying this sort of cart. Is it cart octave she's trying? She's trying this beat across the body and then going down.
True, because Kuhn-Napik is still taller than her, so it's risky to go without blood at this short distance. Because we can see they are really fencing close to each other, so distance is really short. Should be a lot of tension.
If you're new to fencing, that's a lovely hit as well from Anna Kuhn. If you're new to fencing, if the blades, if the tips of the swords are crossing each other, it means they're quite close. They are fencing, they're being quite aggressive.
So now Kuhn has this advantage that she was looking for. She's leading by one.
Beck Miasco looks quite relaxed, quite calm.
Yeah, could be also, you know, some kind of a release for Knapping, because now she knows that she is one touch under. She has to provoke to be creative. She tried, and she has been hit under the hand.
Nice hit. Fake across the top and just on the inside of the wrist. Whole body target, Nepe, so you got to keep that sword arm quite protected. Well, this is a curious match.
Yes, it is. And I think, again, the break is very important for the fencers. That's the period where they can talk to the coach, give their feeling, and receive like any ideas where to go, which target, which part of piece should they use. So this moment is very, very important.
Do you think the experience of Renata Napic here is going to play its part?
It is, but we can also see that she feel like she, if she was looking for an ID, a target, she does not feel very secure about her game. That's why the coach, as we can see, is giving her like advices where to go. He's very prolific in his talking.
Radislav Zavrotniak, if you remember that name.
He is a great fencer, qualified for Olympics.
Lovely chap as well, now coaching Renata Napic Miazga. Start of the third period here, and Anna Kun from the host nation getting the backing of the home crowd. He's 2 points up with 3 minutes of fencing now. She's in control, right?
She is, but Knapik looks more aggressive than on the first two periods. See, she's lunging. She did a great attack, and now it's minus one for her.
Very nice hit, that.
I think she's tempting more actions than on the first two periods. And she has to, because we are 2 minutes to go.
Yeah. But it almost looked like she pulled out of that one. She kind of did the beat attack and then stopped and then went again.
She did.
But this is nice.
That's a single hit, so we are again in the same situation where the score is tight. Let's see if Knapik is going still forward and try to make the pressure and to
like
try some action.
About before, you got back into the in contention. Do you carry on?
Exactly. But probably she will carry on because she has been more successful by leading and trying to be proactive.
And you have to say, the more experienced fencer, you've got to back them. You've got to back them in this situation. So still pressing. Polish fencer on the left-hand side. Try and find a beat.
Yeah, that's a very nice attack. And she was making a remise. And the distance was quite bigger than than before on the first two periods, so maybe that's also an advantage now for Knapik.
For the taller fencer.
Yes.
So now will she sit back?
Actually, I'm not sure she is stepping back, but Kun is maybe more pushing her opponent. But definitely the action has changed the side.
Yeah. So advantage to the pole. With a minute of fencing left. The second chance.
That's a nice try from Kun, because her opponent, Knapik, was at the end of the piece, and Kun tried to go for the feet, because she knows that Knapik cannot step back a lot. So the leadership has literally changed.
Big opportunity here. 45 seconds left on the clock. Napek Miazga looking for a Grand Prix win here in Budapest.
And Kum just did a lovely attack. She scored alone. So the score is now 10-9, 35 seconds to go.
Is she going to go for it?
Yeah, Kum has to go for it. She's still under the pressure of the score. But she has to focus on the distance too. She has to go forward.
Ooh, close there.
Yeah,
Knapik
is still
Knapik.
Very aggressive with her tip. 16 seconds.
Time's running out for Anna Kun. Silver medal here in Budapest last year. She's
and she did it amazing. We again have 10-10. Do you think that she's going to go like in the semi-final or no?
It's so hard to call. I hope she does in some ways, but 8 seconds left, I don't think so. Oh, maybe she is. Maybe she's going to go for it.
Yeah, the distance is so close, 3 seconds to the end.
No,
they are opening, they are opening. So right now, it means that we go to priority. 1 minute, one hit. The priority is on the right side. The first one to score is going to win this gold medal. And if there is no hit at the end of the 1 minute time, Kun is going to have this gold medal.
Is Kun going to go again, do you reckon?
You know, even if you got the priority, you still have to want to get this third. So she has
to pressure,
to.
Yeah. Oh, this is so tense.
Yeah, that's the best moment in fencing.
So Napek Miazga on the left, Kun on the right. Sudden death minute.
The time is an advantage for Kun, but she's trying to go, she's going, and that's a double hit. We still have 27 seconds to go for this gold medal.
Tension is pretty high here now. The home crowd obviously supporting Anna Kun on the right-hand side.
She's trying to keep the field, not to give it to Knapik. Knapik has to go, she knows it. They are trying, Knapik is going for the hit, but that's a double hit again. And now the distance is really important to start the match.
They're just apart, you can see the tips are just away from each other.
Oh, Kun tried to go, that's again a double hit, my God, that's great.
What an exciting final this is here at the Budapest Grand Prix.
And the referee has them for the distance.
Napek pushing. Napek scores! And Napek has done it. She just did a little beat. It was enough to take the blade out of the way. And Kun.
Yeah, Kun tried to go, but she missed. And finally, Knapik hit. That's a win for Knapik. Finally, Kun will keep her silver medal from last year.
And so here we have Renata Napek Miazga, the champion of the Budapest Epe Grand Prix here in 2023. A brilliant final, but another silver medal for Anna Kun from the host nation. Radoslav Zavrotniak coaching now the Polish team. Congratulates Renata Napek Miazga. Kundo, silver medal again here in Budapest. Looks a little disappointed, but what a great result from her today. So our first Grand Prix win for Renata Napek Miazga from Poland. Four World Cup bronze medals, two European bronze medals, but this is her very first Grand Prix win.
And there we see it in priority, an 11-10 win for Renata Napek Miaska.
One more match. It's still to come in today's program here in the Book Hall, and it's gonna be the men's final. And of course, that bout will be followed by the official medal ceremony, which will conclude the program here. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the participants of the final at the Men's Epic Grand Prix in Memoriam Győző Kulcsár. Hölgyeim és uraim, kérem fogadják szeretettel a Kulcsár Győző emlékére rendezett West End Grand Prix férfi párbajtörviadal döntőjének résztvevőit.
Time now for the Budapest Epe Grand Prix Men's Epe Final. Well, what a lineup we have here for this men's Epe final. Gabriella Cimini from Italy has to be the favorite, you have to say. But going up against this young Israeli, Yonatan Cohen, it is a huge final here. And joining me in the commentary box, I'm delighted to say, is Amber Severo. Amber Cimini's got a favorite here.
I'm not sure we can talk about favorite because, yeah, but Cohen is world champion in junior.
Yes.
And he was in European also lately.
Yes. And Israel is a strong fencer. They've been pushing high in men's epe recently.
Yeah, he is. And we never know. We have to fight. We stayed earlier that the level in men's epe is really high. And if both of them are here, meaning that both of them today are really strong.
Yeah. We're underway here in this gold medal match. Cimini on the right, Cohen on the left. Grand Prix victory at stake here in Budapest.
And we already have the first heat. Cimini is again on his side of the piste. He feels comfortable here. Let's see if the game of Cohen can annoy him if he can find a target through. It So Cohen looks like he's preparing his action a bit more than in semi-final. Still pushing his opponent. And that's a new hit for Chimini. Chimini is trying to make his opponent come to his side of the piece. Looks like also he's giving his opponent a hard time with the leg. Once again, it's a single hit for Chimini. Is Cohen going to change the rhythm of the match? Because right now he's fencing according to the rhythm of Chimini. He tried to, but Chimini is definitely very aggressive with his point and is scoring his hit. That's a lovely parry riposte on the shoulder. Four-zero, that's a great start for Chimini. So Cohen definitely has to fight on the side of the piece of Chimini. He's trying to provoke the attack of his opponent to take the break, but he failed. That's a 5-0 for Chimini. It's going to be very, very high to catch up the score. Chimini is still giving the rhythm of the match with his leg. That's a great footwork he's doing. Cohen is looking to provoke his opponent. He tried to once again, but definitely Chimini, with the experience, look well prepared to go to get this gold medal. Cohen is giving the rhythm now. Moving a lot, try to go, but Chimini once again use his amazing footwork, going backward to hit his opponent. And that's a 7-0. Allez. 35 seconds to go before the break. Cohen is not willing to attack his opponent anymore. He definitely needs some advice from his coach. The referee is giving the halt because he is asking the fencer to keep going fighting until the break. They cannot open the distance like this and stop fighting. They have to go until the break. 21 seconds to go. So even if they don't want to really go for the hit, they have to keep the distance, they have to keep fighting until the referee gives a halt for the minute break.
Halt, minute.
And that's done. 1 minute break. The coach, Angelo Mazzoni from Israel, will have a lot of work to do to try to catch up the score. 7-0, it's hard, but it's not impossible. And on the other side, we do have Gabriele Chimini with a strong advance. We can expect that Chimini is going to keep going on this side of the pist. He has been very successful today on that part. Now the break is over. 7-0. Let's see how Cohen is going to do next.
Okay.
What do you think, Karim?
Well, pretty good job so far.
So, Karim, there is 7-0, now 7-1. So Cohen just opens the score.
I got it.
We can see clearly that they are still fencing on the side of Cimini.
But just a dominant performance from the Italian.
It is. I mean, he has been, each time that Cohen tried to make an attack, Cimini was here. But apparently the advice of the coach can be great now because it is two hits more for Cohen.
And the break is so important, isn't it, for the fences?
It is, because Cohen was kind of lost because of the score.
Yeah.
It was big difference. And now 20 seconds and he scored two hits in a row. And another one. He is still aggressive with his points, still going on the feet of his opponent. But not directly attacking him, that's maybe a key.
Do you think the experience of Cimini is still going to play its part, though, in this?
I think so.
What?
I think so, because Cimini has a lot of experience. But four touch in a row. We had 7-0. Yeah, now could be the same on the other side. Who knows?
Switches around immediately.
Yeah. Yeah. See? What? I got it.
Has Cimini won any medals at senior level?
Not yet, actually. He had a silver medal in the World Cup. He had bronze medal, but not in the GP.
What?
Not in the GP, no.
Okay.
So big opportunity for the pair of them here in Budapest, but still have to fancy Cimini, don't you?
He has, but it's actually 5-1 now on this period for Cohen and 6-1, so the score is now 8-6. We can see Cimini he needs to redo his shoelace.
Because
it was undone, but that's also because that's also a good time for him to breathe and to think. You know, he's under a lot of pressure. It's a one-to-one spot fight. So it's also difficult to receive like six touches in a row or 7-0 like he scored before
so
to Cohen.
You take a mental break, right?
And the referee called halt. He goes to the video right now.
Because? Why?
Because he gave the halt, we can see that there is a hit also. He has to decide whether the hit is valid or not, and it will be his decision according to his halt. And the decision of the referee, you know, hit, he gave the halt, so hit is after the halt. No, hit. That's a double hit here, 9-7.
He's pushing him, he's back in the fight. He's right in this fight. After a dominant first period for Cimini, all of a sudden Cohen has the momentum behind him.
Yeah, I think he's really willing to win this gold medal, you know.
Any medals?
No, he never won a medal in a senior competition or in any competition in senior. That's 10-9 now.
Great little circular cyst or cyst if you want. Taking the blade up. And again!
That's really nice. So Cimini tried to change and to go forward to surprise his opponent, but Cohen was ready and he scored a single hit. Now the score is 10-10. We can see the back flip to touch his opponent. What an amazing touch.
Yeah, really nice stuff from Cohen. We're going to see Israel's first.
And Cimini tried to give him the same hit, but Cohen scored also, so that's double hit. Score 11-11.
This is a great... Amber, you are never allowed to leave the commentary box.
That's great to have score like this. And Cohen comes back from a 7-0, whoa, and the score is 12-12.
Oh,
that's
unbelievable.
And he's still going.
Still pressing, still pushing, still trying to find a way through Cimini. But Cimini with a lovely little flick across the top.
I think Bosvenzel likes it, that touch.
There's the circular cease, flick onto the back.
And it's really nice to see. It's very spectacular
touch.
It's
beautiful, of course, yes.
We still have time, but we can see that Cohen is really pushing his opponent.
Very exciting men's épée final here in Budapest. Cimini getting out to a...
That was really close. And Cimini dare to give this attack. That's impressive regarding the context.
Almost took the words out of my mouth here. He took a risk. He took
he
a
did.
Chance.
Straight to the tight.
So one away for Cimini from the gold medal here at the Grand Prix. Debut win for either of these fencers. A 7-0 lead for Cimini was broken away in the second period. But Cohen still looking strong, still looking like he might have a chance here.
He does.
But a double does it. And Cimini, having broken away in the first period, being broken back in the second period, found the resolve. And he's found the gold medal here in Budapest.
So Cimini.
Right, well, Amber, before I get into you're never allowed to leave the commentary box, what a match that was.
That's incredible. I'm not sure I've ever seen such a comeback. And he went tight, and it's a lot of emotion. That's great. And it's first medal in senior for Cohen. That's a beautiful silver medal. And for Cimini, that's a gold. That looks great.
It certainly does. And there is Gabriele Cimini with his first ever Grand Prix gold medal. He'll be on the podium. And that was a brilliant hit. He took that risk early, and he took the gold medal here in Budapest. So, Amber Silveira, I know you have an early flight tomorrow morning, so I will say thank you very much for joining us. Can I beg you to come back to the commentary box again? Because you keep bringing these 15-14 fights.
I will be so happy to join you again, and I think the fencer did their best today, and it's so great to see fencing at this level. So thank you, Karim, for having me here.
Amber Silveira, confirmation here that Gabriele Cimini has won the individual men's épée gold medal at the Budapest Grand Prix, 15-13 over Yonatan Cohen from Israel, who picks up his first ever Grand Prix podium. But Amber Silveira, thank you so much.
Thank you, Karim. Goodbye.
So we will be back very shortly for the medal ceremony here in Budapest. You were listening to the delightful, incredibly informative Amber Silveira telling us about the épée today here in Budapest. But if you don't have time to hang around for the medal ceremony, I can tell you that next week it will be Jeff Bukantz bringing you coverage from the Busan Men's Foil Grand Prix, Men's and Women's Foil Grand Prix in Korea. But we'll be back very shortly for the medal ceremonies here in Budapest.
Előkészülnek tehát a kollégák, és amikor mindenki készen áll majd, az érintett versenyzők is, a díjátadók is, akkor már is jövünk a ceremóniával, úgyhogy még egy kicsit türelmüket kérjük. De hát Kunadnával is találkozunk mindjárt, úgyhogy tényleg érdemes itt maradni, és onnan is megérdemli, hogy méltóképp megünnepeljük ezt a mai fantasztikus teljesítményt.
Hát amíg várakozunk, azért hadd csináljuk egy kis kedvet ahhoz, hogy ismét üdvözlessük Önöket hamarosan itt a Voksarnokban, mert két hét múlva újabb fantasztikus vívó esemény, akkor ugye a kardozóké lesz majd a főszerep, ennek is nagyon-nagyon komoly hagyományai vannak, úgyhogy egy kicsit arra is gyűjtjük az erőt, és aztán ott majd egy újabb fantasztikus hétvége vár ránk, és számítunk mindenkire természetesen, remélhetőleg ott is fényes magyar szerepléssel, magyar sikerekkel. Annál is inkább, mert tavaly emlékezhetünk rá, hogy valóban igazi magyar örömmel ünnep volt itt a Bokcsarnokban, úgyhogy érdemes lesz majd akkor is velük tartani. So, the French fencer, Marie-France Kandasamy, who's one of the bronze medalists, of course, in the women's competition, we are expecting her at the medal ceremony, so... Okay, she's there. Fine. Thank you very much. Minden érintett versenyzőt és díját adott begyűjtünk, de egyelőre még a francia lány hiányzik itt az érmesek közül, so Marie-France Kandasamy, please go to the core room, because we are waiting for you right before the medal ceremony. So if you can hear us, if you can hear me, then please join the other medalists of the women's competition.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the participants of the medal ceremony of the Women's FA Grand Prix in Memoriam, József Sákovics. Hölgyeim és uraim, kérem fogadják szeretettel a Sákovics József emlékére rendezett West End Grand Prix női párbajtőrviadal díjátadó ceremóniájának résztvevőit.
Time now for the victory ceremony of the women's épée here at the Budapest Grand Prix. It's been a fantastic tournament for sure. Now we get to celebrate with the podium athletes who've battled their way through.
The medals will be presented by a díjakat átadják Sákovics Négy Dömöki Lidia, Olympic Champion, widow of two-time World Champion, József Sákovics. Olimpiai bajnok, a kétszeres világbajnok Sákovics József özvegye. Schmidt Gábor, Deputy State Secretary of Sport, sportigazgatási és fejlesztés ügyekért felelős helyettes államtitkár. And Kovács Sobor, Head of Marketing at West End Shopping Center, a West End Shopping Center marketing igazgatója. Bronze medalist at the Women's Competition, bronzérmes tehát a női versenyben, representing France, Marie-Florence Kandasamy.
So the two bronze medalists from France, Marie-Florence Kandasamy, and on the right-hand side, Nelly Differt. Great day for the pair of them, picking up third place here at the Grand Prix and a bag load of ranking points. Back-to-back silver medals here in Budapest for Anna Kuhn from the host nation. Oh, she was so close in the final, so close. But it's another silver medal for her here in her home city. Seven-year-old from Poland, Renata Napek-Miaska, collects the Épée Grand Prix title from Budapest 2023. And a special prize for the top Hungarian athlete here in Hungary, going to Anna Kuhn. Second time in a row for her.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please rise.
So, super performance from all four of the podium athletes, but now it's time to celebrate with Renata Napek-Miaska with the Polish national anthem. We'll be right back.
Congratulations to all medalists.
So there we have it, the women's podium complete. Nelly Dipper from Estonia is joined by Marie-Florence Candasamy from France in the bronze medal position. Anna Kuhn from Hungary collects the silver medal for the second time in a row here in Budapest. But it's a podium debut gold for Renata Napek-Miazga from Poland, taking the EPE Grand Prix of Budapest 2023.
Egy utolsó programban van hátra a férfi verseny díjátadó ceremóniája, és azzal zárjuk ezt a mai napot, illetve a versenyt. So the last action coming up now, that's gonna be the medal ceremony of the men's competition in a few moments. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the participants of the medal ceremony of the Men's Epic Grand Prix in Memoriam Győző Kulcsár. Hölgyeim és uraim, kérem fogadják szeretettel a Kulcsár Győző emlékére rendezett West End Grand Prix férfi párbajtörviadal díjátadó ceremóniájának résztvevőit.
Time now for the victory ceremony for the individual men's epee competition here at the Budapest Grand Prix.
Thank you. kulcsárgyőző, a négyszeres olimpiai bajnok kulcsárgyőző özvegye. Dr. Schwindpál, Olympic Champion, former President of Hungary, olimpiai bajnok, Magyarország korábbi köztársasági elnöke. And Gyulai Zsolt, Olympic Champion, President of the Hungarian Olympic Committee, olimpiai bajnok, a Magyar Olimpiai Bizottság elnöke.
Well, what a tournament it has been here in Budapest. Gaetan Bia, his podium debut here, collecting the bronze medal. A superstar in the making, for sure. Will he make that team for Paris 2024? Joined on the podium by Valerio Cuomo, another superstar in the making.
Silver medalist, Ezüstérmes, representing Israel, Israel képviseletében, Jonathan Cohen.
What a fencer this man is from Israel. The silver medal goes to Jonathan Cohen from Israel. I think we're going to see this guy a few more times on the podium at World Cups and Grand Prix. Superstar for sure.
Gold medalist and the winner of the men's competition here in Budapest. Aranyérmes és ezzel a budapesti Grand Prix verseny férfi versenyének győztese. Representing Italy, Olaszországból, Gabriele Cibini.
He's waited a long time for this, but it's a debut Grand Prix win for Gabriele Cimini from Italy. What a win for him. 7-0 up in the final. Then absolutely broken in the second period by his silver medalist opponent, but he came back in super fashion to take the gold medal. And now it's time to celebrate with him and the Italian national anthem. To Gabriele Cimini from Italy. Jonathan Cohen from Israel collecting the silver. Gaetan Bia from France and Valerio Cuomo collect the bronze medals. A superb tournament here in Budapest, as always. Fantastic. Join us next weekend for the men's and women's foil Grand Prix in Busan, Korea, where Jeff Bukantz will bring you all the commentary from the round of 32. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you soon.
And see you next time. Bye for now.